Hello students, let us discuss about bearing capacity of soil. Yesterday I have told about Terzaghi's bearing capacity equations for C5 soil and cohesive soil and also non-cohesive soil. In the case of non-cohesive soil, there is only friction, C is equal to 0. So the formula for stiff footing is Qf is equal to sigma dash nq plus 0.5 gamma beta n gamma. For rectangular and square footing, this is the equation, and for circular footing, this is the equation. Okay, so whatever I have told till now, that equation is applicable for general shear failure. Suppose if there is a local shear failure, the equation for bearing capacity is slightly different. Okay, for that case, if a soil is relatively loose and soft, it fails in local shear failure. Such a failure is accounted in bearing capacity equation by reducing the magnitudes of strength parameters C and phi as follows. So that means tan phi dash is equal to 2/3 of tan phi. So C dash is equal to 2/3 of C I have to take. Okay. In case of the local shear failure, that phi value you have to consider it as tan phi dash, that is equal to 2/3 of tan phi. And similarly for C, it is C dash is equal to 2/3 of C. This is the difference between the general shear failure and local shear failure. In general shear failure, directly you can take the values of phi and C, but in case of local shear failure, you have to take phi value as 2/3 of tan phi and C value as 2/3 of C. The following table summarizes the bearing capacity factors to be used under different situations. If phi is less than 36 degree and more than 28 degree, it is not sure whether the failure is of general or local shear type. In such situations, linear interpolation can be made and the region is called mixed zone. Okay, suppose if it is less than 36, you can go ahead with the general shear failure. If it is more than 28, it is local shear failure. But sometimes what happened, phi value lies between 36 and 28 degree. So which case you have to consider? In such situation, linear interpolation can be made and that region is called as mixed zone. You can see here, this is the local shear failure if the phi value is less than 28 degree. So you have to consider NC dash, NQ dash and N gamma dash. And mixed zone is, it is in between 28 degree to 36 degree phi value. So you have to consider NCM, NQM and N gamma M. Okay, if it is phi value greater than 36 degree, then it is a general shear failure. So it can take the values of NC, NQ and gamma. These values I have shown already in the last class using the table. Depending on the phi value, you can take NC, NQ and gamma value, NC dash, NQ dash and gamma value. But this value can be obtained by the interpolation. Next, we'll see what is factor of safety. It is the factor of ignorance about the soil under consideration. It depends on many factors such as type of soil, a method of exploration, a level of uncertainty in soil strength, importance of structure and consequence of failure, likelihood of design load occurrence, etc. Assume a factor of safety F equal to 3 unless otherwise specified for varying capacity problems. Okay, if there is if the factor of safety is not given in any of the numericals, you can consider it as 3. Okay, these are the some of the typical factor of safety for bearing capacity calculation in different situation. The category wise, it is mentioned A, B, C. And typical structure. Suppose if it is a railway bridges, water warehouses, blast furnaces, hydraulic retaining walls, then characterization of the category is maximum design load likely to occur often, consequence of failure, disasters. So you have to take through the through and complete soil exploration 3 and limited soil exploration 4. So you can take it as 3 value and 4 value. Okay, for a second category, that is highway bridges, light industrial and public buildings, then can consider factor of safety as 2.5 and 3.5. And apartment and office buildings, maximum design load likely to occur, unlikely to occur. So here you can consider factor of safety as 2 and 3. Okay, these are the some of the typical factor of safety for different situations. Next, let us see what are the factors influencing bearing capacity. There are different factors which affects the bearing capacity of the soil depends. The first one is the type of soil and the unit weight of soil, surcharge load, depth of foundation, mode of failure, size of footing, shape of footing, depth of water table, eccentricity in footing load, inclination of footing load, inclination of ground, inclination of the base of the foundation. These are the factors which affects the bearing capacity of the soil. Now let us see what are the effect of water table fluctuations. Okay, the basic theory of bearing capacity is derived by assuming the water table to be at greater depth below and not interfering with the foundation. This is the basic assumption before designing any structure, but it will not happen always. Okay, however, the presence of water table at foundation depth affects the strength of soil. Further, the unit weight of the soil to be considered in the presence of water table is submerged density and not dry density. Suppose if there is a water table, you have to consider the submerged density, not dry density. Hence, the reduction coefficients Rw1 and Rw2 are used in second and third terms of bearing capacity equation to consider the effects of water table. So, if there is a water table, the equation is slightly modified by considering the reduction coefficients, that is Rw1 and Rw2. So, these are the two conditions. Suppose now the water table is here, okay, which this is the depth of the foundation, this is the width, and water table is located here at a distance of Rw1 from the ground level. Okay, so such cases you have to consider the reduction factor, that is Rw1. Sometimes what happen, the water table is located below the foundation level. In such cases also, here the water table is located here. This is the depth of the foundation, this is the width, and this is the Rw2. So here also you have to consider the reduction factor, that is Rw2. We'll see in detail. The ultimate bearing capacity with the effect of water table is given by this formula. In the previous formula, what I have shown in that this term was not there, Rw1 and Rw2, because I have not considered the water table effect that time. But if there is a water table, you have to consider that. So the equation is slightly modified to like this: CNC, ultimate bearing capacity, is equal to CNC plus gamma d NQ Rw1 plus 0.5 gamma b N gamma Rw2. Okay, here Rw1, this is calculated by using this formula: 1/2 into 1 plus Zw1 divided by D, where Zw1 is the depth of the water table from the ground level. See, you all should know all these terms, otherwise it is very difficult to solve the numericals. Okay, so this term D is the depth of the foundation, Zw1 is the depth of the water table from the ground level. Always this Rw1 value, it is in between 0.5 to 1. Okay, it is less than more than 0.5 and less than 1. When there are again some conditions, if the water table is at the ground level, then Zw1 equal to 0. Okay, so this equation Rw1 becomes 0.5, because you have to substitute 0 here. So what happens, this whole term becomes 0. So half into 1, that is 0.5, half. Next case, when the water table is at the base of the foundation. Now the water table is at the base of the foundation. So what happens, that Zw1 is equal to D here. Water table is here. Okay, so this Zw1 till here it comes, the depth of the water table is Zw1, that is equal to D. Okay, so then Rw1 is equal to 1. How? Substitute this Rw1 is equal to D. D divided by D is 1. 1 plus 1 is 2, 2 into half, that is 2 into 0.5 equal to 1. Okay, at any other intermediate level, RW1 lies between 0.5 and 1. These are the two conditions. When the water table is at the ground level, RW1 is equal to 0.5. When the water table is at the base of the foundation, RW1 is equal to 1. Okay, if it is water table is in between any other levels, then you have to consider the value between 0.5 and 1. Similarly, for RW2, this is the formula, 1 divided by 2 into 1 plus ZW2 divided by B, where ZW2 is the depth of the water table from the foundation level. This is here. This is the ZW2. It is the depth of the water table from the foundation level. Okay, so here again same conditions. The RW2 value should be in between 0.5 and 1. When the water table is at the base of the foundation, that is ZW2 is equal to 0. Because ZW2, if the water table is at the base of the foundation only, then there is no ZW2, okay? In this case, if the water table is here only, then there is no ZW2, that is equal to 0. So, when you substitute ZW2 is equal to 0, this term becomes 0, so half into 1, 0.5. When the water table is at a depth B and beyond from the base of the foundation, that means that W2 is greater than B, then you will get RW2 is equal to 1. Okay, in any other intermediate level, RW2 lies between 0.5 and 1. So, these are the conditions you should remember before solving any numericals. Next, density of soil. In geotechnical engineering, one deals with several densities such as dry density, bulk density, saturated density, submerged density. There will always be doubt in the student's mind as to which density to use in a particular case. In case of bearing capacity problems, the following methodology may be adopted. Always use dry density as it does not change with the season and it is always smaller than bulk or saturated density. If only one density is specified in the problem, assume it as dry density and use. If the water table correction is to be adopted, use saturated density instead of dry density. On portions above the water table, use dry density values. If the water table is somewhere in between, use equivalent density as follows. In the case of shown in the figure, if the water table is here, then gamma required should be used for the second term and gamma saturated for the third term. Okay, in the case of second case, if the water table is here, then gamma D should be used for the second term and gamma E required for the third term. This gamma required, that is calculated using this formula, gamma 1 D1 plus gamma 2 D2 divided by D1 plus D2. So, these two conditions also you have to remember. In addition to this, there are three cases. If the groundwater table is at the ground level, water table is here, this is the width of the foundation, this is the depth of the foundation, then bearing capacity equation gets modified. Gamma of the second and third term becomes gamma dash. You know where that is gamma, because CNC plus gamma D and Q plus gamma B, that formula, in that second and third term, in that formula second and third term becomes gamma dash. Instead of gamma, it should be gamma dash. Okay, if the water table is here at the base of the footing, in this case the gamma in the second term remains same, but gamma in the third term should be replaced by gamma dash. This is for the second condition. This is first condition, at the ground level, groundwater table is at the base of the footing. Third one is, if the groundwater table is below the base of the footing. Now here, okay, this is the breadth, width of the foundation, depth of the foundation. If the depth of the water table below the base of the footing is greater than B, then there is no change. If the depth of the water table is greater than B, there is no change. But if it is less than B, then gamma in the last should be replaced by gamma average. So gamma average can be calculated using this formula, where dW is the depth of the water table below the base of the foundation footing. Thank you.